times I'll say it up here. If God's not here, what are we doing here? Okay? God needs to be here. Let's welcome Him. This is His house. This is His service.
Change my heart, oh God. Junior, but would you just ask the Lord to comfort him in Give him peace. Father, in the name of Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
It's an honor, Lord, to be in your presence, to be with your people, Lord. People that have faith, people that have like faith, people that can agree and touch heaven on any given subject when it comes to healing. When it comes to great concern with the body of Christ, we have. I pray for your cousin this morning. Lord, I believe you've given him a miracle. Lord, there's so many good things that have transpired in his life since this diagnosis of horse-stained cancer in his lung. But God, I know that you're able to speak to him right now. Let him feel the prayers of the saints and give him comfort and give him great consolation. And just, Lord, maintain and continue his healing in his body. I pray and ask it all in the majestic name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Everybody said amen. God bless you. Thank you this morning.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for your prayers. We do believe that God answers prayers, don't we?
Yes.
We do believe that he's still the healer. And we know that he uses technology, but I've always believed that all of science and all of technology, that God, the creator of everything, has given mankind the ability and the knowledge to learn and create and so on and so forth. So regardless of what happens, the miracles and the things that take place, it certainly is to God be the glory. Why don't we just give the Lord a hand clap. Thank the Lord. I'm going to share a few thoughts here with us this morning. Nothing new. Seldom little is preached about Joseph, and I want to share some thoughts about him today. Like I said, I love to read these scriptures, and I'm going to begin reading again this morning. I read this a few weeks ago. I'm going to go a little different angle with it this morning. If you turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter 1. I'd like to read verses 18 through verses 25. Verses 18 through verses 25. This is how Jesus, I'm going to read from the New Living Translation. This is how Jesus, the Messiah, was born. His mother Mary was engaged to be married to Joseph. But before the marriage took place, while she was still a virgin, she became pregnant through the power of the Holy Spirit. I never tire reading that, do you?
Yes.
I never tire reading it. I never tire hearing it read or listening to it be read, regardless of what time of the year it is. These are just such wonderful, powerful scriptures. Joseph, her fiancé, was a good man and did not want to disgrace her publicly. So he decided to break the engagement quietly. And as he considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. Joseph, son of David, the angel said, "Do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child within her was conceived by the Holy Spirit. She will have a son, and you're to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." We need to read that every day. Meditate upon that every day. All of this occurred to fulfill the Lord's message through his prophet. "Look, the virgin will conceive a child. She will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God is with us. When Joseph woke up, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded and took Mary as his wife, but he did not have sexual relations with her until her son was born. And Joseph named him Jesus. Father, I thank you. As always, thank you for your wonderful, wonderful word. And Lord, I thank you personally, and I'm sure everyone would share my heart in saying this. I thank you this morning, Lord, personally for this wonderful, wonderful season. As we celebrate the birth of our Lord and our Savior. Father, we never grow weary or tired of hearing these beautiful, beautiful scriptures read. We never grow tired, Lord, of hearing the message of Christ, his birth, We never grow weary, Lord, of the power that resides within the written Word of God. So we thank You this morning. And I thank You in advance, God, for touching our hearts. And I submit myself and humble myself, Lord, in Your presence and in the presence of Your people today. Lord, would You use my vocal cords? Would You anoint me this morning, Lord? Without it, I just simply cannot do it. So I trust You and pray that Your sweet Holy Spirit will go before me this morning and touch our lives, touch everyone under my voice today. And as always, if there's anyone here today that doesn't know Jesus as Lord and Savior, what a grand and glorious moment in time to accept You, Christ, as Lord and Savior. And I thank You, God, for all of Your blessings and everything that You do for Your children. And I humbly ask it in the mighty, everlasting, matchless name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Everyone said,
Amen.
Amen. When Joseph woke up, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded and took Mary as his wife. I want to use for a subject a few moments this morning, a humble man called to a heavenly mission. A humble man called to a heavenly mission. When God moved in time to send His Son Jesus into the world, God chose a great vessel when He chose the virgin named Mary. And we know this without me elaborating on this. We don't exalt Mary. We don't believe that she is a part of the Trinity. We believe that she was a precious young woman that obviously was devoted to God and that she was pure before the Lord and she maintained that purity.
Yes.
So God chose this great vessel, this precious young girl, this young virgin named Mary. And of course, since the birth of Jesus was to be a virgin birth, there would be no need for a human male to father the child. However, as Jesus was coming into the world as a helpless infant, and since God was sending His Son, think about if it was your son. Since God, I've said this 1,000 times over, God sent heaven's best for this world's worst. And aren't you glad that He sent heaven's best for you? Amen. And so since God was sending His Son into this world to live in poverty and not splendor, I could take that little sentence right there and probably expound on that for at least 30 minutes. Someone said the other day, we make reference, and Jesus came to this world to live in poverty and not splendor. And we all know, I hope we know, that this was a choice that the Trinity made before Jesus stepped out of heaven and was conceived by the Holy Spirit in the womb of a virgin named Mary. Because we all recognize that our Father owns a cattle on 1,000 hills. He not only owns the cattle on 1,000 hills, He owns all the hills that the cattle graze on. So we realize that God incarnate, Jesus Christ, when He came to this earth, He could have lived in a mansion.
Yeah.
He could have been born in the most elaborate hospital of that time. I don't suppose there were even any hospitals of that time. But Almighty God could have created, He could have spoken into existence an elaborate hospital. And we know that Jesus, wherever silver might have been buried in caves or underground or any gold or anything that would have made life easy, the Lord knew where all of these things were stored. So, because He is and was part of the creation, He was with God, and they were together when they spoke this great universe into existence. So, God was sending His Son into the world to live in poverty and not splendor. There would be a great need for someone to provide for the needs of this child. Therefore, God chose the man Joseph to be the earthly caretaker of His heavenly Son. It would appear that Joseph was no ordinary man. It's easy to see that Joseph was a man of compassion. He was a man of integrity. He was a man of decency. And he was a man of love. He was a man who honored God's will in his life personally and was totally committed to doing God's will. Joseph was a humble man who was more concerned about what God wanted out of his life. life than about what he himself wanted for his own personal life. He was a humble man chosen for a heavenly vision.
Yes.
I can see in Joseph a man who possessed a certain characteristics that marked him as a very special man. He was the kind of individual we could strive to be. I don't know about you, but I sure would like to have his spirit all the time. Perry said something this morning about that he wasn't the only one, you know, maybe was struggling to keep a maintain the right attitude, the good spirit. But you know what's so wonderful about that? We that have Jesus living and residing in our hearts, we all do have our moments. If you have your moments, would you raise your hand? Everybody has their moments. But what's so good about the moments that you and I, as believers that have already accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, when we have our moments, my wife and I were doing something, involved in something the other day. I'll tell you what happened. She probably won't even tell this. I got more frustrated than she did. We pulled it. And you know, Liam, if I'm late, you need to send somebody looking for me. Yeah, I'm serious. I think I've been late for one church affair in 46, 47 years. And I got caught in a Thanksgiving parade in Southwest Virginia, a little town somewhere away from Bristol. It was back out across the railroad tracks. And we got hung, and I was to be the speaker there that night. And anyway, we were late. But my wife and I had gotten everything we thought. We had everything together to come to our banquet Friday evening. By the way, did you enjoy that banquet? Wasn't the food wonderful? And wasn't the fellowship even better than the food? So we had gotten into the car, and I'd driven, and we intended to get there a little bit earlier. Of course, the traffic was getting a little heavy about that time, so we got out on the interstate and turned off. Was going to go to get on 209 to go into Bysville from that direction. And she said, "Oh my goodness." And when she says that, I know something wrong. I said, "What is it, honey?" She said, "I forgot the Christmas gifts." I had my moment. Y'all can hear me confess it, huh? I said, "You know what? Just forget it. Don't mess with it. Nobody care anyway." So I could tell she didn't like that. So we went down the guy I am. I said, "Well, then you do know if I turn this car around, go all the way back to the bar stage, we're going to be late for the dinner." I can tell she was aggravated, too. She don't get aggravated. She was aggravated, yeah, because she did forget it. But anyway, so I can tell both of us were having a moment. I can tell both of us. I'm looking this crowd on my tail. Y'all never had those moments. Some of you can't really have that around you when you had the moments. But we had a moment. And I just thought, now, Lord, I'm not going to let the enemy of my soul mess up beautiful fellowship tonight. So I turned the car around, we drove back, and we didn't say anything to each other for probably a minute and a half. That's not a long time for her, that's a long time for me. And I looked over at her and I said, "I tell you what, let's do it. Let's say in our spirit, let's say four times, let's repeat in our spirit, I have a mind of Christ and I have a heart of God." And I'm telling you, I stopped the car, she got out to go in, I said that four or five times in my spirit. I said, "I have a mind of Christ and I have a heart of God." And when she come out with those gifts, we just turned that car around and I drove a little faster because I knew we were going to be late. And so I kind of pumped it up a little bit, but by the time before we got there, everything was okay. And I'm saying that to magnify our wonderful celebrating Jesus. We're celebrating Jesus, but only because of Jesus can we conquer, can we overcome. You know what would happen in these brief moments that we have? If it was not for Jesus, it wouldn't be a momentary situation. It would last for 3 or 4 minutes. It could last for 3 or 4 hours. It could continue for days. It could continue until it erupted in your soul and you lose favor with God. Aren't you happy about Jesus this morning? If you are, just give a great example. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Joseph was the kind of individual we should all strive to be like. I'm most sure that the Lord will not call you or call me to go through what Joseph went through. I'm pretty positive of that. However, I'm sure that God wants to use you, and God wants to use me for His glory, for His honor, just as He used Joseph. Now, I want to point out, just for a few moments here this morning, some details of Joseph's life that marked him as a man God could use. Do you want God to use you this morning? We're getting ready to start a new year. Years and years go by, and you keep trying to come up with something fresh and something new. The only thing fresh and new that I can come up with that's old to us is to do our best to love Jesus, to serve the Lord, to be faithful to Him, to the message of eternal salvation, to be committed to God, and to be committed to the family of God, to be committed to the body of Christ. Joseph was a man handpicked. I really like that. He was a man handpicked. I will tell you, I can handpick you.
Yes.
And I want to encourage you this morning and admonish you in the same breath almost. I want to encourage you. He has handpicked you, and He has chosen you, and He has given you a mission. You need to do everything on your part that you possibly can to fulfill the mission that He's given to you. He was handpicked and personally prepared by God for a special mission. His life was not without trials. His life was not without tragedies. In fact, Joseph faced, weathered, and overcame trials that would have derailed many other people.
Amen.
And look at what Joseph faced and how he responded can have you and I as we seek to become all the Lord would have us to be. Joseph, you know this. Joseph was betrothed to a young woman named Mary. The betrothal period, for all intents and purposes, was just like a marriage, except for the fact that the couple didn't live together, unlike today, and did not engage in physical relationship, unlike today. Both parties were expected to keep themselves pure, unlike today.
Amen. Yeah. Amen.
Right. I don't even know if this generation today knows what pure is, what purity is. I think I told you this one time before. Out on the West Coast, my wife and I were with another couple from the church, and their kids were there with us, and my pastor friend ordered a virgin daiquiri. A virgin daiquiri. That's a sweet drink, but they put alcohol in it. But he ordered it without any alcohol. And the waitress, she soon brought our drinks back first, as they always do. And my pastor friend, he didn't even put it to his mouth. He picked it up like this, and he could smell liquor in it. And he looked across the table at me, and he said, "Brother Bobby, this drink is not virgin. This drink has alcohol in it." I said, "Alan, you forget where we are. We're in California. They don't know what virgin means out here." This is a serious time. It really is. Both parties were expected to keep themselves pure for the day they physically came together as husband and wife. It was common for the betrothal to last several months or longer, possibly even a year. It was during this period of time that Joseph discovers that Mary is pregnant. No doubt you know all of this. No doubt she shared with him her side of the story as the phrase, "She was found with child of the Holy Spirit." I can just imagine Mary trying to explain that to the love of her life. You don't have to really put on your imaginary cap to figure this out. I can imagine her trying to explain and give a definition or be definitive to Joseph. "Joseph, I'm pregnant." And Joseph is saying, "How in the world could this happen? You're a virgin. We've never been together sexually. I love you, Mary. I adore you, Mary." And you can only imagine where it went to from there in Joseph's mind. But no doubt she shared with him. She tried to explain to him the presence of the angel. But who had ever heard of such a thing? Joseph knew where babies come from. And to him, this was a shocking discovery. No doubt like most men. No doubt like most men. Can I hear an amen from the men this morning?
Amen.
Joseph was looking forward to the day he and Mary came together to share their lives. He was probably preparing the home they would live in by trade. He was a carpenter. He was busy putting together all the things they would need as husband and wife. And I'm sure his days were filled with work and his nights were filled with dreams about the future he held for Mary. Then a cruel, cruel slap in the face came when the news had shattered all of its hopes and dreams. Mary's pregnant, and Joseph is not the father. For a time, it must have felt like his heart had been ripped right out of his chest. It must have hurt as every dream he had came crushing down around him. All of his plans, listen carefully, all of his plans, all of his hopes, and all of his dreams fell from his grasp as though they were grains of sand. And for Joseph, it was a time of shattered dreams. Now Joseph is faced with a real dilemma. The Bible says that he was a just man. You know this? This meant that he was righteous and one who kept the divine laws. This meant that Joseph knew what the law said. When a woman is found guilty of adultery, she was to be stoned to death according to Deuteronomy chapter 22, 20 and 22. But there was another option according to Deuteronomy chapter 24, verse 1. It says that he can just give her a bill of divorcement and send her away. As Joseph meditates, he determines that he doesn't want to embarrass Mary publicly. He was a gentleman, wasn't he? He really was a gentleman. I won't say too much right there, but I don't know too many men like Joseph. So I want to just brag on him this morning. What a heart he had. What a gentleman that Joseph was. And so he meditates and he determines that he doesn't want to embarrass her. He certainly doesn't want to see her stoned to death either. So in his mind, the best course of action is to deal with the matter privately and just divorce her quietly. Boy, would you like to see one of them today? I don't know the people that I've known personally, including some of my friends, even ministers. Boy, that one would knock your socks off if it went quietly. There's always a big fight, isn't there? There's always some kind of dilemma. But when these things happen, it breaks our heart because it isn't what we wanted or what we expected, and it looks to us, though, it would be the worst thing possible in Joseph's life. I would think that this is certainly what he felt. As he pondered these things in his heart, and as he meditated upon these things, and again, this was a time for sorrowful decisions. Have you ever had to make a decision that you were really made you sorrowful? Yes. It troubled your heart. But what a portrait! What a portrait, church, of the harsh reality of life. We do our best to make our plans and to get things lined up like we think they ought to be. Then we see our hopes. I want to reiterate that. Then we see our hopes, our plans, and our dreams come crashing down. And when these things happen in our lives, it breaks our heart because it isn't what we wanted or what we expected, and it looks to us as though it would be the worst thing possible. But like Joseph, we're blind to the fact that God is working behind the scenes. In fact, it was God who shattered our dreams. The things that take place in our lives, in your life, and in mine, are not accidents. Yeah. I know there was a horrible thing that happened to you a few months ago. I know all of us have had tragedies in our lives and things that happened that we simply did not understand. But accidents, the things that take place in our lives, I especially believe in the believer's life, are not accidents, but are carefully planned and arranged events designed to help us grow in the Lord. That's hard for us to understand, but it's still true nonetheless. I said that's hard for us to understand, but it is still very, very true. God works out His plan in our lives in ways that we cannot begin to comprehend. If I were asking you to stand this morning, everyone under my voice, no doubt, you could talk about experience that you've experienced over the many years of your life, things that you have gone through with, things that come up quickly, come up instantaneously, things that you didn't have a dream that would come up. I've talked to so many people, parents raising their children, husbands and wives that have been together for decades, some as long as 40 years have lived together, raised family, and seemingly done well in life, and all of a sudden you hear somebody, no, did you know that Jack and Sue Ann were getting a divorce? God works His own will in our lives in ways that we cannot begin to comprehend. His plans are not what we would have chosen for our lives, but His plans for us are always the best. Amen. I want to say that again. His plans for us are always the best. Amen. His plans for you and I are always the best, even when they hurt us deeply. I've had some of my greatest hurt come from God's people.
Amen.
Time would go by. Incidents would happen. Shirley and I were, many, many years ago, were involved in a situation in a church. It was before we even left Virginia. It was great. It was wonderful. Things were going absolutely wonderful. And all of a sudden, something turned around. All of a sudden, somebody said something. All of a sudden, someone began to spread something. And the ultimate was, it crushed me and Shirley. I'm telling you this for the glory of God. So we decided we're going to go somewhere and spend a few days. We're going to leave town and we're going to find us a motel somewhere. And we're just going to spend that time together, that time alone. We had someone to babysit the kids. This has been many, many years ago. This is the truth before God. I am certainly not a preacher that believes that he can wait till he gets in the pulpit on Sunday morning and open the scripture and just turn to it, or have somebody come up and say, just open the Bible and I'm going to preach from wherever you point out for me to read. I don't think we'll believe that back and fly. You have to prepare. You have to study. You have to meditate. God can do anything, but there's some things He's expecting you and I to do. But my wife and I were crushed over that. Don't need to get into detail. That's irrelevant. But we were crushed over that. But it was not an accident. And it was not an accident when we decided we'd go somewhere for a few days and spend time alone and pray together and get our composure together. Because we had some of those moments. Have you ever had those moments? We had some of those moments. But this is the truth before God. Nothing is an accident in our life. God has a plan in your life. There's books that are written about God having a plan for your life. But I'm serious this morning. I don't care who you are. You may be prominent. You may not be prominent. You may be well known. No one may know you. But I'm telling you this morning, everything that God places in your life is always going to work out for His glory and for your good. Both of us. Yeah, give the Lord a hand clap of praise this morning. Both of us were nearly devastated over this. I looked at her, she cried, and I cried. I'd say, I don't know what in the world I've done. I'm a pretty good fellow. I love people. My preaching is reasonable. I just don't have a clue why in the world this would happen. This is the truth before God. We went into the motel. We checked in. We went into the motel. That was back in the day when the Bible was prominent.
There was
a Gideon Bible laying on the end table in this motel room. And it wasn't just lying there upside down or just covered over. It was open, wide open. And if I can remember, I think it's in Romans where Paul said, all things work together for good to them that love God and to them that are called according to His purpose, to His plan, to His structure for their life. Right now, I have a Holy Ghost spell. Somebody said, yeah, but you were just young and dumb and didn't know any better. Well, I'm older and still not a whole lot brighter, but I do know better. I know that all things work together for good to them that love God according to His purpose. Hallelujah. According to His plan. And we love Him. And we honor Him regardless of what comes upon us. God is going to give us a revelation. God's going to give us knowledge. God's going to give us understanding. He will teach us and show us precisely what we need.
Amen.
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 So anyway, where was I? God works. God works out His plan in our lives in ways that we cannot begin. You cannot begin to comprehend. I would have never thought, I would have never dreamed. That's just one little incident. Many times, over years, all of them, I could give you time, each one of you, to stand and testify to the Lord working something out miraculously in your life to bring you from a feeling of anxiety and being overwhelmed to victory in the Lord. His plans are not what we would have chosen for ourselves, but His plans for us are always the best, even when they hurt us deeply. We may not like it when the Lord shatters our dreams, but when everything has been said and done, we will see that His plan was and is the best plan of all. We might as well face it if we're going to be used greatly of the Lord. How many want to be used greatly of the Lord? We might as well face it if we're going to be used greatly of the Lord. There will be some personal dreams that will be shattered along the way. And in the middle of this great tragedy in the life of Joseph, God placed a call upon him. God assigned. God, if I say God assigned. Joseph didn't appoint himself. God assigned Joseph a task that many would have balked on. But it was a task that Joseph embraced and completed by faith. A great tragedy may have marred his life, but this same task marked his life for God. I'm preaching a humble man called to a heavenly mission. Joseph is instructed that he's not to divorce Mary, and he's not to have her stoned, but he's to take her to himself as his wife, and he is to embrace her child as his own son. Joseph is told to name the child, thus he is given the responsibility of caring for and providing for baby Jesus. This man is handed a difficult task, to say the least. Have you ever had a task that difficult? After hearing what is required in his task, Joseph learns the amazing truth. The baby Mary carries is to be the fulfillment of the great, I love this, to be the fulfillment of the greatest promise God ever made to man. Read Genesis 3 and 15. For thousands of years, the faithful have been looking down through the corners of time, waiting for a moment when God would send His Redeemer, when God would send the Messiah into this world. And aren't you happy that He sent the Redeemer? Aren't you happy that He sent the Messiah? This one who was being formed in the womb of Mary. All the prophets looked ahead to this glorious moment in time. Read Isaiah. I won't take time. Read Isaiah 7:14. Read Isaiah 9 and 6. All of creation groaned for the day when the child would come and deliver this world from the bondage and the blight of sin. Aren't you happy that when at some moment in time that you accepted Him as your Lord, as your Savior, as your Redeemer, hallelujah, and you can lie your head on your pillow at night and close your eyes and you can say, Jesus, all is well. Hallelujah. I'm happy to stay here. I'm happy to live here. I'm happy to do whatever, Lord, that you assigned me to do. Because you are my Lord. You are my chief bishop. Hallelujah. 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 Praise God. Then Joseph hears an angel tell that this child is to be named Jesus. Why? Because he will be the one who will save his people from their sins. His name will define his mission. Jehovah is salvation.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Somebody, I believe it was the other week, somebody sent me a text, not a text, but an email yesterday, and it was a t-shirt that a teenager was wearing, and inscribed on this t-shirt, it said, Dear God, why do you allow violence in school? Signed, a concerned student. God replied, Dear concerned student, I'm not allowed in schools. God.
Amen.
Anywhere that Jesus Christ I'm sure Joseph didn't understand everything that was happening. I'm certain he didn't grasp all the importance of the moment. But if he did, then he would have understood that God was entering into the world through the womb of a virgin. And that just absolutely, I flip out on that. Just something about that. I see y'all are getting that just like I am. But just something about God entering the world in the womb of a virgin. He would have understood that God, who is spirit and feels all things, was coming into this world in the person of a helpless infant. Listen carefully. He would have known that Jehovah was coming to live in his house. He would have known that Jehovah was coming to learn his trade. He would have known that Jehovah was coming to sit on his knee and then go up to die for the sins of Israel and this world. Joseph probably didn't understand it all, but I believe he got enough to know that God had just transformed what he thought was the worst nightmare into what would become his greatest blessing. Joseph understood enough so that he could put his shoulder to the love of God and call him to bear with joy. Humble man called to a heavenly vision. Often the way we look at life is like watching a parade go by while standing between two tall buildings. All you're able to see of the parade is the portion that's passing directly in front of you at any given moment. You have a memory of what has already passed, but you have no idea of what is yet to come. You have to wait until it gets to you. But if you were to climb up on top of one of the tall buildings, you would be able to see the parade is in its entirety. Listen, you can see the beginning of the parade. You can see the middle of the parade. And you can see the end all at the same time. You can see the end all at the same time. There will be no surprises. And just briefly here this morning, isn't that the way oftentimes we see life? All we can really see is the part that happens to be passing before our eyes at the present time. Sometimes we have a blurred memory of that which has gone by. Some of us sitting here this morning, including myself, I have some memories I wish I could forget. Don't you? And there are things that have happened to you that you wish that you could forget. But sometimes there are blurred memories of which has gone before us, but we have no idea. We have no idea about what's coming our way. Our God, however, sits above it all. He sits on the circle.
Yes. Yes.
To him there are no surprises. He knows the end from the beginning because he planned it all the way through.
That's right. Amen.
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 The best thing we can ever learn to do is to simply trust God to bring the best in our lives day by day. Even when our dreams are shattered and our hopes are dashed in pieces on the jagged rocks of reality. Oh my, I say this so often, and it does not have a negative effect on my faith in Christ at all. He is everything.
Yes, yes He is. Yes, He is. Amen.
But this that we are involved in, this atmosphere that you and I live in, this is real. It's reality. Things happen. Bad things happen. Struggles come. Many times difficulties happen. Even our dreams are shattered. Our hopes are dashed on the jagged rocks of reality. We need to trust the truth that our Father is still in control.
Yes.
And He cares for His children.
Yes.
Despite what you and I may think at times, God does know what is best for you.
Amen.
I know we all say that.
Amen.
We all say that, but then sometimes we get off ourselves and pout. But God does know what is best for us. Conclusions. God took a poor, humble carpenter and used used him to carry out an important heavenly vision. Did you know he's still looking for special people he can use to carry out his will in the world today? Are you aware of that? I hope you are. I'm sure he'll never ask you to do what he asked Mary and Joseph to do, because Jesus was the first immaculate birth ever. None before, none after, and shall never be another. So obviously, no one will have to go through that sort of situation. But I am certain, I really am certain, I believe this with all of my heart, that God has plenty of difficult assignments that need to be fulfilled. I think difficult assignments. You know, we live in such a hyper church world today that we ministers, leaders in the church, we get so caught up with the limelight and how often we're seen, how often we are heard when we're here to do one thing, and that's to serve at the feet of this Christ that we're celebrating in His birthday. That's all we are here for. That's what we are called for. He's looking for people who will follow him in spite of the tragedies of life. He's looking for people who will take the task he assigns them and go for God. Well, that's what I'm looking for. That's what I'm looking for in our church here. We need some more people that will hear the still, small voice of the Holy Spirit. We need some people to connect with others of like faith. We took our grandson, I'll tell you this quickly, I shared this with two or three of you the other day. We took TJ to a specialist, to a, what is it, ENT, ear, nose, and throat specialist, Dr. Winks. And what a delight. I mean, TJ's had strep three times in the last 11, 12 months. And so his little tonsils are as big as my thumb, I'm not exaggerating. And he's even not been sick with it, and they maintain that. They never are any less than that. They're always swollen. And so we had an appointment set to see Dr. Lynch this week, and the 4th of January, they're going to remove his tonsils and possibly his adenoids. But as we sat there, Dr. Lynch brought it up. He brought it up about the things of God. I mean, it just overwhelmed me just for a few moments. And so we talked, and we even talked about transgender. We talked about this homosexual lifestyle. And you know something? I got a message. I'm going to tell you. I'm going to work this out. I got a message from Dr. Lynch. I believe God had him to say it so I could pick up on and get God's inspiration. We were talking about how that people will not accept Jesus, how that people are just, you know, they just want to do whatever. It was just a great conversation. And he said to me, and he looked at me, and he said, there's something about intellectuals. There's something about intellectuals that, and he used himself because obviously he's a specialist. He's a medical doctor. And he said there's something about intellectuals that they have to try to determine and figure everything out scientifically and figure everything out logically. And of course, he said what I said over, you can't figure God out logically. And so, and the Lord gave me such a golden opportunity to say some things to him that, I, to be honest with you, there are some Pentecostal people I couldn't even, wouldn't have the liberty to say to them what I said to this doctor. He looked over at Shirley and I, we talked for 15 minutes. I'm comfortable. 15 minutes. And it was a very spiritual, not just theological. You can talk theology and still not be spiritual.
That's right.
Amen. And he looked at Shirley and he said, oh, what a delight. He said, it's so great to be able to talk with someone that of like faith.
Amen.
And he said, where's your church? And Shirley said, why didn't you give him a car? Well, to be honest with you, oh me, I wasn't even thinking about him coming to church. I was just carried away with talking to a medical doctor that didn't think he was smarter than God.
Yes, yes.
But I tell you, there's people out there that love Jesus.
Yes.
Genuine faith in God. Genuine faith in God never seeks the easier road. Faith is willing to go where God breeds it, regardless of the cost and regardless of the consequences. Real faith says, on the surface, this looks like the worst thing I've ever faced. Still, I know God has gone ahead of me. Listen to this carefully. Still, I know God has gone ahead of me and that He has planned the path I will take. Therefore, I will not look to the right or the left. Well, that's what throws us off sometimes.
Yes.
We get caught up and carried away with things that are so insignificant.
Yes.
But I will faithfully, I love this. I wish this was original, it's not. But I will faithfully place my feet in the footprints He has already left in front of me.
Amen.
I will follow Him wherever He sends me. And I will not turn back in spite of what I face.
Amen.
It may look like a nightmare at this moment. But I know that His plan is the best plan. And He will take this tragedy and turn it into a triumph. Therefore, I say, here I am, Lord, send me. That's what the body needs today.
Yes, yes it is.
That's what the body needs today. Our Father, who sits on His throne, in His majesty, in His splendor, and in His ivory palaces, what He needs to hear from every born-again believer. Lord, you know, sometimes we try to convince God who we are. We tell God how old. I bet I've told God how old I am. The last 2 years, more than ever told Him in my life. I said, God, but I'm just like, oh boy, that's some heavy stuff, dude. God, did you forget when I was born, Lord? And sometimes we get, you know, we look at situations and circumstances presently. I want to say to you, speak this in your heart this morning. Whatever God has challenged or chosen you to do, whatever God has assigned you to do, please stop trying to figure out how meager it might be or insignificant it might be or even how significant it might be. I think it's so wonderful. I think it's the greatest thing in life just to simply be born again.
Amen.
Let alone to think He would take this classic letter and do something with it. Call someone to be blessed. Speak something great into someone's life. Not always be pessimistic. Speak something optimistic. Maybe even when you don't feel like speaking something optimistic. You and I, as believers, can always be optimistic. In this one sense, Jesus Christ is alive and well in our hearts. Hallelujah. We can always be optimistic about Christ and His love because He dwells within. He really resides in our hearts. Glory to God, church. That's not a figment of your imagination. That's not some preacher's promise. That is the Word of the living God. He is in my heart. He lives in my heart. He resides there. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Let me say that one more time. It may look like a nightmare at the moment, but I know that His plan is the best plan, and He will take this tragedy and turn it into a triumph. Therefore, I say here, I am Lord. Send me.
Amen.
Yes.
Let's try to finish up this year with that. Let's try to begin the new year with that. Let's try to counter these. Dear God, why do you allow violence in the school? That's the answer. He is the only answer. When people ask the question, God's this great loving God, why does he allow all of this, these tragedies? Why does He allow all these murders? Listen to me, people. It's not an issue whether He allows it or not. He's God. Something I heard someone say the other day, God is a gentleman. any place you don't want Him. Whether you do it politely or not, if He's not wanted, He's not going to go there. He's not going to stay there. He's not going to abide there. He's not going to reside there. So when people ask these questions that are so dominating today, if God was this, why? If God, there's no if God with me. It's just God. Not if God. What if God was this? Or what if God? He's God. He is beyond questioning. Sometimes we do, but He is beyond questioning. He's so high. He's so above us and everything because He is God. God bless you today, and I hope you'll have a blessed day today, and the Lord will be with you and minister to you. He'll treat you well. He'll treat you well.